Nutters, welcome to the Bucknuts Morning Five here on Wednesday, February 28th, 2018, final day of February. I am Dave Biddle, very happy joined by the People's Champ, Matt Baxendale. Bax, Ohio State's spring football practice kicks off Tuesday. If we needed any more reminders, I mean, the weather's been great here in Columbus. Spring ball now kicks off Tuesday. We'll start off talking about the strengths of the team this year. Let's take D-line off the table, even with, like, losing, like, four future NFL guys. This D-line is loaded. That's going to be, the strength of the team, in my opinion. Let's take that off the table. In your estimation, Bax, what is going to be the strength or the strengths of this team?
I mean, that's a cheap move, taking away the easy answer with the D-line. Geesh. I guess we'll have to be more creative here.
I know.
That's all right. So I'm gonna be a little creative here. The position everybody's talking about is the position of strength for Ohio State, and that's quarterback. Because guess what? Dwayne Haskins, well, you know, both of us are very, very much on the Haskins train. Guess what? Joe Burrow's no slouch either. He's still my number one leader to be Nebraska's starting quarterback this year. And I say that only because I think Haskins beats him out, and there's no reason for Joey B to sit. He's a very good quarterback. Tate Martell, guess what? He was only one of the top recruits in the country and provides a complete different dimension. That's a position of strength. And I'm going to stay on the offensive side of the football. Think about the wide receiver position. What did Ohio State lose from last year? Not very much. You bring back a wide receiver group that's going to be a year better, a year more experienced, and guess what? They're going to have a better quarterback throwing the ball to them. That's going to help their stats a lot, too. Heck, I could talk about the running backs, too. I mean, really, I love the skill positions on the offense this year. I mean, it's not just because Weber and Dobbins are great at running back. Look at the rest of the group. I mean, DeMario McCall, nobody talked about him last year, and he was a guy I thought was going to explode. He could easily be a big-time player this year if he gets the touches. And then the freshmen, Snead and Teague, are going to be great. And by the way, Antonio Williams didn't suck either. So you have to love, love, love the skill positions on the Ohio State offense this year. And I think that's where I'm going to go with their position of strength, since you're taking away the Bosa crew on the D-line from me.
I am, yeah. And let's dig deeper on wide receiver and running back. Let's start with wide receiver. Extremely deep, but, like, all these guys are, like, talented, yet still have not, in any of our opinions, like, reached their potential. And if they all do, or, you know, a high percentage of them are able to do that, look the hell out. I'm with you. I like this group. I mean, everybody's back. They could withstand injuries and still be very deep. That's how deep they are. Talk more about the wide receivers. Is there anything that gives you pause about thinking that they're going to have a big year?
Yeah, the real simple answer why you'd be concerned about the wide receivers is because each of them have one notable flaw. Everyone has their own kryptonite. Paris Campbell, amazing athlete, can't catch, right? You have Terry McLaurin, never been consistent, but you could see him easily catching a bunch of deep balls this year. Johnny Dixon, will his knees hold up? I mean, Benjamin Victor, will he ever be consistent? We could keep talking about each of these guys' different abilities, right? But the truth is, none of them is the number one. You have a lot of twos. Who's the alpha? Who's the Michael Thomas of this group? We don't know that yet, and that's what we need badly. You know, I think that's something that's going to be very interesting to watch happen is who's going to be the guy who leads this group? Because you've got a lot of guys who are pretty darn good. Do you have anybody who's truly elite? That's what we need to know from the wide receivers, and that's what I'm hoping to see in spring football. And you know me, I'm always hoping it's going to be Benjamin Victor just because of the, you know, quote-unquote measurables and the fact that ever since Friday Night Lights a couple years ago, I was screaming with excitement about him. So...
Austin Mack is the one guy, I think, in that group that could break out. If there's going to be a number one receiver that actually breaks out, and there's other candidates, you know, if you want to give them, in my opinion, a smaller percentage to guys like Terry McLaurin, Paris Campbell. Paris Campbell, I think, could break out in other ways, though, you know, handing the ball off to him as a kick returner. Things of that
yeah,
nature.
Kick returner.
But, you know, hopefully, you know, I mean, I know that because of, like, you know, concussion concerns, they took that job away from him late in the year, but hopefully they get him back out there as a kick returner. But, Austin Mack, that's the one guy that intrigues me the most if one guy's going to step up as a number one.
Haskins likes him, too. Haskins has looked at him whenever he's been in. And we've seen Mack make a big play in a lot of games this year. He had the catch against Oklahoma, obviously the massive play against Michigan. He's another one of these guys, though. Like, again, is he going to be consistent enough? We haven't seen him do it enough. He has one or two big plays in a game, and then you don't see him, right? So which one of these guys is it going to be? That's the real question right now. And that's what we're kind of waiting and sort of – maybe we'll find out in spring football. Maybe one of these guys goes out and has a Michael Thomas kind of spring. But remember, we also had Bam Tildress and Torian Washington in the spring, and we all know how that panned out.
Running back, you touched on it. Let's talk a little bit more about that. I mean, I can't remember – we had a former Ohio State player talking about this in the boarding house yesterday. The depth of running back, and not just the amount of bodies and where they're ranked in the recruiting rankings, like – the quality depth they have there. I mean, they have 2,000-yard backs, guys that have rushed for 1,000 yards at Ohio State, including the best freshman season ever with J.K. Dobbins. You have Mike Weber back, the other 1,000-yard back, who also had a good year last year, you know, once he finally got healthy. I really like Antonio Williams, as you mentioned. And then you land two stud recruits. I mean, really it would have been successful if they landed one of those guys, if we can be truly honest about it. You land two high four-star running backs. Master Teague for a while was, you know, kind of underrated as a number three. You bring in Brian Snead. Teague's already enrolled. I mean, DeMario McCall is also going to play running back and play some H-back. I mean, they are stacked at running back. Talk more about that, Bax.
We haven't even mentioned Jalen Gill yet. Let me think about that. You know, the guy was the number one all-purpose back in the country. He's going to play an H-back sort of role. He's a guy that Ohio State's been looking at since an eighth grader coming in this year. And we haven't even mentioned him in the top six guys. That's crazy. Think about the talent that they have. I mean, the real question is going to be, though, is are they going to come into some sort of rotation that makes sense? You and I had this discussion all year last year, right? Why is J.K. Dobbins running the ball on third and one? Why is Mike Weber carrying the ball on first and 10? Whenever Dobbins is the home run hitter kind of guy, and Weber's going to get you that extra hard yard. I like Weber's breakaway speed that he started showing late in the year. Actually, it has me really excited about him this year, whereas I really wasn't last year at this time excited about him at all. But right now, I mean, what are you going to do? Are you going to run the ball the whole game? Or, I mean, we're all talking about Dwayne Haskins opening up the offense and airing it out, right? So the real question is, we do have enough touches to go around, because you're going to have a lot of games this year we go, how the hell did Mike Weber only have six touches? Or where was J.K. Dobbins for two quarters? I mean, we're going to have that same conversation again because you have too many weapons. And that's going to be the real interesting thing, because with all those guys in spots, you're not going to tire these guys out. And I think it's going to be very interesting to see how they split the reps this year. But the raw talent, there's no one in the country that compares Ohio State to running back right now. And I know that's a big statement, but guess what? There's no more of that Georgia two-headed monster. Ohio State has the best tailbacks in America. They need to take advantage of it in 2018.
Real quick, we'll finish the show with some hoops. Buckeyes will be back in action in the Big Ten tournament on Friday. Big Ten Network, 6:30 p.m. Eastern. They'll play the winner of Penn State Northwestern. It'll be obviously at Madison Square Garden in New York, which is why it's a week early. And, you know, for a one-off, I like it. You know, if it was like this every, you know, 3 or 4 years, I wouldn't like it. But for a one-time thing, I like that it's in New York City. I want you to comment on that, Bax. I also want you to comment on Kata Bates-Diop winning Player of the Year in the Big Ten, Chris Holtmann winning Coach of the Year in the Big Ten, and his chances to be Coach of the Year nationally, Jayshon Tate, second-team Big Ten, at least for the coaches. Somehow media didn't have him as second or third-team Big Ten. The media, my media brethren, dropped the ball on that one. Andre Wesson, all-freshman team. Just give me your thoughts on all of that.
Okay, let's see here. First things first. I'm glad Ohio State had a coach win Coach of the Year at something. I'm surprised Kirk Ferentz didn't win the award. Just you know, saying, I thought he won every Coach of the Year award in every sport. But it's nice to see that, you know, Chris Holtmann was recognized for being the best coach in the Big Ten, because clearly he was this year. He took a team that was held together with chicken wire in June and ended up almost winning the entire conference. And if he's not the National Coach of the Year, I don't know what in the world is going on. That's if he's not the National Coach of the Year, then Rick Pitino does run a clean program. Let's put it that way. Now, as for Kata Bates-Diop, of course, he had a fantastic year. You have to be amazed at the way he's played. And the only thing I have to say negative is I hate having the Big Ten Conference Championship in New York City. We're not a New York City conference. Put it in Chicago or Indy, where the Big Ten people actually live. I think, you know, yay, publicity, whatever. No. The Madison Square Garden's the Big East. We all know that. Nobody associates that. It'd be like the Pac-12 saying, well, you know, we don't want to be part of the Rose Bowl anymore. Just keep your conference championship in Big Ten country. That's the one thing that annoys me. And by the way, if it wasn't so jammed tightly together and scheduled to fit in this stupid publicity stunt, maybe Ohio State wouldn't have ran out of gas down the stretch, and maybe they'd have won the Big Ten. So that's something to think about if people are fond of this New York crap. I am not.
Well, there you go. We disagree on that. Like I said, I would agree with you if they were planning on doing it again. As a one-time thing, I'm cool with it. And maybe I'm cool with it because the Big Ten schedule didn't affect Ohio State since they were 15-3. Picked 11th in their conference and finished 15-3, but I hear you. I think.
Yeah, but it could have been 16-2, you know? Well, or what would have happened with a little more rest?
Well, I do recognize this. I'm in the minority. I think most people I've talked to do not like the fact that it's even in Madison Square Garden. You know, one year, I've been co-hosting Tim and Beanie for the last few weeks while Beanie's been on vacation, and, you know, my co-host Tim Hall is, like, adamant that they should not be doing this. He's right in line with you that, like, this is In fact, it really, I think it keeps him up at night. Like, it's like, I don't think about
it. It's like hosting the Super Bowl in Moscow, Dave. All right? It's insane. There's no reason to have the Big Ten Championship in MSG. Tim Hall is 100% right. Hey, that sounds like a good plan. Let's have the NBA title game played in Singapore. I mean, come on.
It's like, it'd be like Major League Baseball, like, opening up its season in, like, Japan.
But Japan makes sense. They at least like that. They like baseball in Japan, though. Nobody likes the Big Ten in New York. Nobody likes the Big Ten in New York. Rutgers is not New York's Big Ten team. Rutgers is a team New York looks down on because they're not from New York. They're from New Jersey.
You're right about one thing. I mean, like, Syracuse is the team, like, as far as college
Notre Dame is the team. Notre Dame is the team in New York. There's no other team in New York. It's Notre Dame.
There's a lot of Ohio State. There's a lot of Michigan. But Syracuse is for men's basketball. Syracuse is the team in New York. All right.
We're going on a tangent. We could do this for a while. Whenever, if Tim Hall decides to go on vacation, you talk to me. I'll have a fun 3 hours with you on fiddle and bats instead of Tim and Beatty.
We'll bring you in. That'd be
of course, you'll just get ganged up on. Tim will just be like, yeah, Bax is right, Dave. And you'll be like, come on, guys.
Hopefully the producer would be on my side. Well, he is the people's champ. Read his column every Sunday. It is the bucket. It is must-read material. Matt Baxendale, thank you very much. And thanks to all the listeners out there for tuning into the show. I appreciate it. I hope you have a great day. Let's hear that Buckeye swag, best damn band in the land.